Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to King of Kings, you are my everything, and I will adore you. Flashes of lightning, roars of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Struck wonder at the mention of your name, Jesus. Your name is power, breath, and living order. Such a marvelous mystery, yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God.
Christ King would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. Well, was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I
great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my step down from glory.
fulfill the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim.
Church family, and all those tuning in on YouTube this morning, we are so glad to have you a part of this broadcast today. As you can see, we are not in our facility today. We have just chosen to exercise some prudence, some abundance of caution today. We've had some positive COVID diagnoses in the community, and today we just want to honor some good space and invite you to join us virtually today. So we are glad to have you connect in this way. We look forward to when we can get back together in person again. Lord willing, next Sunday, we hope to be outdoors and enjoy some of God's beautiful creation and have an outdoor service next Sunday. So again, welcome everybody. So glad to have you a part of this broadcast. I'm Pastor Steve Zwart of Unity Christian Reformed Church, and we're glad to have you connect in this way. As we gather for worship today, I want to invite you to just set your hearts towards worship. Wherever you're gathered today, to set your hearts towards honoring and worshiping God, would you pray with me? Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for calling us together, even if it's in a unique way like this today. I thank you for your presence that goes out from here, from your throne room, to touch people's lives. And wherever we're gathered today, Lord, we thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit. And I pray, Lord, your blessing and favor on this broadcast, our time of worship together. And I pray that you are honored and glorified in all that we say and do. To you be all the praise and the glory, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Let all the earth
As we pause now in our worship time today, I'm going to invite you to join me in prayer. And as we pray, of course, we're a worshiping community, a worshiping family. If you're somebody that's tuning in today that is not directly connected to our Unity Church family, we invite you to join with us in prayer today for some of our brothers and sisters in Christ who are in need of prayer. Particularly today, we want to remember Daryl and Bev. Daryl is finishing his journey here on earth, and we just want to lift up Daryl and Bev as they close this chapter as husband and wife and on this side of eternity, and we pray God's peace for them. We also want to remember our brother in Christ, Norm, as he prepares for surgery at the end of this month, a major surgery. And as he deals with some infirmities right now, we want to lift up him, his wife Val, and their family as they walk this journey together. As I mentioned at the opening, we do have several families that have been touched by COVID, and we just want to lift them up in prayer as well and invite you to join us in lifting them up before the Father in heaven. So would you bow your hearts with me as we spend just a few moments in prayer together. Father, we thank you for your love and your mercies that are new to us today. Lord, wherever we're gathered today, Lord, we know that you are present, you are with us, and your mercies have come to us in this new day. Lord, we thank you for your grace shown to us. Lord, we recognize that our lives are not always this honoring sacrifice to you, but rather, Lord, so many times we selfishly turn and do our own thing. And Lord, we confess that before you, because so often it's so easy, Lord, to have our eyes fixed on just our stuff and my circumstances and our things. And Lord, you call us to seek you above all, but to love our neighbor as ourself. And Lord, we fail. We drop the ball on that so many times. So Lord, we confess that and we thank you for your grace to us in Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins that is ours through Christ. And today, Lord, as we seek your face, we commit anew today to following you, to honoring you in all things, to love you in all areas of our life, to worship and honor you through everything that we say and do, through our workplaces, through our homes, through our occupations, Lord, our communities. We seek to honor your name and lift your name up. But Lord, we also commit ourselves to loving our neighbor as ourself. And Lord, where that's especially difficult, Lord, we pray for your grace to renew us, so that we may extend that grace to others. Lord, today too, as we study your word and study the power of your healing mercies, Lord, we do ask for your mercies to be fresh and new to your people. Particularly today, we want to lift up Daryl and Bev. Lord, we thank you for the legacy and the journey of life that Daryl has lived this side of eternity. Thank you for his love for you, for his wife, for his family. And Lord, as that journey draws to a close, Lord, may your grace be sufficient to him, and that your mercies be new to him and to Bev today, Lord. And until that day, Lord, Daryl steps into eternity and sees you face to face. So we pray your grace to them today. Lord, we also want to lift up your servant Norm and his wife Val and their family. Lord, as Norm prepares for surgery in a couple weeks, but also, Lord, as he deals day to day with some of the challenges, physical challenges that he has, Lord, would your grace renew him as well today? And for his wife and family and caregivers, Lord, that you would strengthen them as well. And Lord, too, there's many people, not only in our own community, but around the region and around the world, Lord, that have been touched by COVID and families and livelihoods been disrupted. And so we pray your healing mercies. We pray your peace be upon your people wherever they are. Lord, wherever there is suffering and injustice today, Lord, that you will come with your grace and mercy and touch people's lives. Lord, as we think on your word today, I pray that you will give us eyes and ears, Lord, to take in what it is that you desire to speak to us today. And particularly, Lord, as we think about your compassion, your love, and your healing mercies, Lord, may our hearts be encouraged today to be ambassadors of good news, ambassadors of hope, and yes, even ambassadors of healing to peoples and to nations and to communities. To that end, Lord, we devote ourselves to honoring your word and the leading of your Holy Spirit. And all these things we ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
I've been held in your hands from the moment that I wake up till I lay my head. I will sing of the goodness of God. I love you, Lord. Oh, you're my.
mercy never fails me. All my days have been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Invite you to, if you have a Bible near you, I want to invite you to open with me to the Gospel of Luke today. Luke chapter 17. We're going to read just a short passage, the verses 11 to 19 today. It's a familiar story. It's a story of 10 lepers that come to Jesus and ask for healing. And this is a powerful story, certainly of healing, of compassion, but I want to point out a few things about this story today that maybe we didn't always catch when we read this story. But it's powerful details that I think speak not only to that situation back then, but also speaks to our day that we live in. So I'm going to invite you, if you would, just follow along with me from Luke chapter 17, beginning at verse 11. And this is what we find recorded here. I'm using the English Standard Version of the scriptures. So Luke chapter 17, beginning at verse 11. On the way to Jerusalem, he, that is Jesus, was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." Now, when he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, Were there not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" And he said to the man, "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." Thus far, the reading of God's word. Again, just a powerful story of God's compassion and love towards this group of lepers. But as we get to thinking about this passage, I want you to just take a few moments to think about the last 6 months and think about the times that we're living in. Certainly, as we dealt with this pandemic, one of the things we were all challenged with was the whole idea of quarantining and social distancing and limiting our contact with people. And especially those of you who've maybe had exposure to COVID or are dealing with it, understand the importance and significance of distance and isolating. And that's not always an easy thing as social creatures. And what we're finding is there's some very adverse effects to isolation and being distanced for extended period of time. So we certainly understand that, say, if someone is under the weather or certainly dealing with some symptoms that can be catchy, sure, we understand the importance of that distance. But over a period of time, that isolation, that being kind of distanced from people, can really have an adverse effect. Now, that's addressing kind of specifically when we're dealing with, you know, physical illness, especially contagious illness. But there are certain realities in our world today where that idea of isolation, of distance, of being forced apart is a daily reality. And it doesn't take some kind of catchy physical illness to implement that. In fact, there's people today that feel very isolated and very distant from others. Sometimes those with mental or physical disabilities feel like they don't fit, like they struggle to find their place, and oftentimes are looked upon as weaker, as insignificant at times in our world. And it's sad. And many of them live with measures of distance and isolation that really grieve our hearts, and it should not be. Or there are those that maybe make very significant mistakes in life, poor choices, and their lives seem to be upside down constantly. And over time, bridges get burned and relationships sour, and they too, in their mess, find themselves distant, alone. Those who battle with depression oftentimes feel like they're all alone in this world. And it's hard. It's really hard. And I'm sure we can think of other situations where people, maybe based on the color of their skin or their ethnicity or other features or other circumstances that naturally result, or I maybe should say unnaturally result, unhealthily result in isolation, distance, and aloneness. I share this with you because it's really important to understand the significance of what happens in this story in Luke 17, because it ushers in the kingdom of God. We see a snapshot of the kingdom of God that, as it were, pushes through all those things that seem to distance and isolate people. And Jesus, as it were, walks right into the thick of it to bring the kingdom of God, to bring hope, to bring healing. And that's the message I want us to hear today as we think about this story, that that's exactly what God's heart is. That he has a heart that whether it's a physical limitation like leprosy, as we'll see in this story, or all these other things that I just listed that result in people feeling separated and isolated and distant and alone, God has a heart to come to meet us right in the middle of it and to bring his mercy, to bring hope, to bring healing. And I hope you hear that today in this story. So I'm gonna break it down a little bit for you, and I want to highlight some maybe smaller details in this story that you may or may not catch as we're going along. So if you have our Bibles open, if you look at the opening verse, it says that Jesus is on his way back to Jerusalem. And I want to just even stop right there because that's a significant detail that Luke includes here. Why is that significant? Because Luke is noting the fact this is the journey back to Jerusalem where Jesus is going to die, where he's going to give his life, sacrifice his life, and usher in the hope and the healing and the promise that's going to come through the power of the cross, his death and resurrection. And Luke wants us to know that the backdrop to this miracle that we read in this story is a backdrop of the unfolding heart, unfolding kingdom that Jesus is all about. In fact, God's healing in this particular situation really reveals the essence of his kingdom coming and his will being done here and now. Sometimes we think that God's healing and restoration is meant for just when Jesus returns. And there is an element of that's true. The full consummation of the kingdom will happen then. But for right now, God is interested already now for us to witness, to see his power, his healing power come. And Jesus, on his way to Jerusalem, where he will defeat the powers of sin and evil through the cross, death on the cross, is going to usher in the kingdom of God right here, right now, into the lives of these 10 lepers. And I want us to just note here that God is always at work in this way in our world today, that God's kingdom is constantly being revealed, and it's revealed when God's people step into, as it were, some of the messiest of situations to bring hope and restoration and healing. Maybe it's not just physical healing. Maybe it's healing of communities. Maybe it's healing of relationships to restore people. God's heart is for that. And so we see in this story this grand revelation of God's power and healing in this moment. But I also want you to note a detail that Luke highlights here. The story says that Jesus is heading back to Jerusalem, and he's heading back between Galilee and Samaria. Now, again, this is an important detail. Don't miss this. Galilee and Samaria were enemies. They were at odds with each other. Jesus was walking through hostile territory. He was walking a road that divided two groups of people that were seriously at odds with each other. What I'm refreshed by is the fact that Jesus was not afraid to walk that road. Jesus, as a rabbi, as a teacher, as a Jew, was not afraid to walk that road. Why is that significant? Because in Samaria especially, there was a loathing of the Jews that were from outside Samaria. I mean, if you were a Jew of kind of Jerusalem, Galilee region, you were despised by the Samaritans. And vice versa, Galilee and the Jews of that region regarded the Samaritans as it were unclean. You just simply did not do business with them. And here's Jesus. I love this. Luke notes us that Jesus is walking this road between Galilee and Samaria. And this really sets up, in a way, the story here, because scholars believe this group of lepers that came to Jesus was a mix of Samaritans and Galileans. Now, isn't that interesting to think about, that this group of lepers that were from regions that were at odds with each other actually had a camaraderie, a commiserating, as it were, together. They stuck together. Why? Because they were outcasts. You have to understand, leprosy was regarded as seriously unclean, a curse. And if you had leprosy, you were forced out of the town. You could not come near people. And leprosy, it's a skin disorder, and it's an ugly thing. It has a very distasteful appearance. And so, as it were, the only way the communities could deal with those who were lepers was simply to put them out. You did not associate with them. So you've got Galilean lepers and you've got Samaritan lepers that both are outcasts, but they have found a camaraderie together because they're outcasts. So I want you to catch this moment here. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem to give his life. He's walking a road that divides two people groups that hate each other. And he comes across a group of outcasts. Outcasts that are hated by both. So not only do you have this division between two regions, you've got a group of people that are hated by everybody. And herein comes Jesus. See, God's healing crosses lines. And we have to remember, never limit the timing and the territory of God's healing endeavors. In other words, sometimes we think some of our own circumstances, or maybe the circumstances of this world, are simply the kind of things we don't even want to think about and we don't want to deal with. And those are exactly the areas God is interested in bringing his healing mercies to. He does not want this world to suffer under these kind of distancing, ostracizing kind of phenomenons. He doesn't want hatred. He does not want division. He doesn't want outcasts. And Jesus comes right into the middle of it to bring God's kingdom, God's healing. And that needs to set the tone for us as well. I don't care what the circumstances are. I don't care how deep and dark the situation is. God has a heart to bring his healing, his kingdom into that area. So never miss that moment. And so if we read on in the story, the 10 lepers, they see Jesus and they cry out to him. But Luke notes the fact that they stay a distance. If you have your Bibles there, it said, verse 12, as he entered a village, he met 10 lepers who stood at a distance. Okay, so Luke is catching this picture of, okay, these lepers are ostracized and they're keeping their distance from Jesus, but they're crying out to Jesus. Now, a couple scholars argue that part of the side effects of leprosy affected the vocal cords, as it were, of those that battled leprosy. So the picture here is one of you've got outcasts that in this kind of almost irritating, kind of irritable, raspy voice are crying out to Jesus. Jesus, have mercy on us. Now, did they know Jesus? Did they have a relationship with Jesus? Well, scholars believe that they maybe heard of Jesus. And certainly when Jesus was coming along and there's this entourage with him of people that are following him, they probably put two and two together and said, this is the guy that we hear that does healings. And so just even in a measure of mustard seed faith, they cry out for mercy. And Jesus steps into this situation to bring that healing mercy. And God's healing comes near where the world, and yes, even the church, often keeps its distance. I think we live in a day right now in a highly toxic culture where there's so much animosity and loathing, as it were, of one another, that God's heart is beating fast for the church, especially the church, to step into, yes, some pretty dicey situations to speak the coming of the kingdom of God, to speak healing and hope and promise into some of the deepest and darkest places, whether it's politics or issues of justice or issues of reconciliation or issues of even just care for one another, compassion for one another. Now is the time. Now is the moment. And God is asking his people to step to the plate and make it happen. And the question is that you? Is that me? Are we ready to shrink the distance to the people that are pushed away by the world, that are pushed to the margins of our society? Are we ready to go there and bring the healing power of Jesus? Well, as we know from the story, Jesus right away turns to them and he says, go, you're free. Go check in with the temple. You are healed. And away they went. And the scripture records, and they were cleansed, washed. They became whole again. Now, can you imagine being this outcast, this person who is relegated to the periphery of society, and suddenly, I mean, just suddenly, miraculously, you're in. You no longer have that which separates you. You have been cleansed. You could about imagine these guys just leaping and jumping and looking at their arms and faces and realizing this miracle had come. And Jesus sends them away to synagogue and to, as it were, testify that they're clean, that they've been declared clean. See, God's healing recognizes that there's a certain holiness, there's a certain restoration in connection that happens through healing. Now, we can think of that tangibly, practically. You know, so for these lepers, suddenly they're healed and restored and now can have community and relationship with people where they didn't before. But God's heart goes much deeper than that. He's not interested in just a physical healing manifesting, but in this relationship desires a closer walk with him. And what we're gonna see in just a moment in the one who comes back is that clicks for him. That in this healing moment, in fact, let's just go there right now. God's healing really opens the door to gratefulness, and gratefulness opens the door to reconciliation. The man realized he had been healed and had received the touch of God, and something stirred in him that drew him back to the healer. Certainly, he could have run with the rest of the guys. And we probably wouldn't have necessarily even faulted him for that. But something stirred in him to recognize the awesomeness of this moment. And I want you to notice that Luke captures an important detail. Do not miss this. Remember at the beginning of the story, they kept their distance. Now they're healed. Where do we find the one? Look what Luke says here. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, this is verse 15, turned back, praising God with a loud voice, and he fell on his face, where? At Jesus' feet. The distance, the separation was done. And he drew close to Jesus. God's heart is that this business of distance, this separating, dividing, and ostracizing that goes on in our world for whatever reason, runs contrary to his heart for people to draw close to him. That through reconciliation, through restoration, through restoring brokenness and bringing healing and hope to relationships and community, even entering in and bringing a prayer of healing and hope to somebody, there is a restoration and ultimately a drawing close to God. That's his heart. God's healing opens the door, yes, for gratitude. And I think we need to lift up our voices loud and clear when we see healing and hope and restoration taking place. But we have to recognize that that's not the end. But in a way, a calling. Because God's heart ultimately is restoration and reconciliation for people to come close to him. Yes, certainly we want to see the miracles and we want to see the healings and we need to pray for those. Absolutely. We have to walk into situations believing God can do immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine. But understand going into that, God's heart is that for every tribe, every language, every people to draw close to him. That's the heartbeat of Jesus. That's the heartbeat of the kingdom of God. And so here I want to leave you with this. As you think about this story of the lepers and you think about maybe those areas in your life where you're experiencing some distance. Maybe you've got a fractured home. Maybe things are not going well at work for you right now. Maybe you're dealing with COVID and you're in isolation from people right now. Maybe economically, ethnically, you find yourself looked down on. Maybe even ridiculed and relegated, as it were, to the periphery, as if nobody cares about you. I want you to hear this today. God's heart is for you. God's heart is for each one of you. God wants to come into your place of brokenness. God is not afraid if there's division, if there's animosity, if there's hatred, if there's separation. He doesn't care. He wants to come into that place right there and bring you his hope and his healing. And that's my prayer, is that not only are you experiencing that directly from God himself through his Holy Spirit, but I want to believe today that we, the Church of Jesus Christ, can be those ambassadors of reconciliation. We can be the bearers of hope and healing in all areas of life. May we carry that love and that grace and that hope and that healing to a hurting world today. Would you pray with me? Father, in Jesus' name, I pray today that in this proclamation of the word, we may hear your heartbeat for healing and hope for the nations today, for our communities, for our land, for all those today, Lord, that are listening, that are broken, that are sitting on the periphery, have been pushed to the edge, that are separated, isolated, distanced. Lord, come, have mercy today. Jesus, I pray that your power would be made manifest in people's lives. I pray for each person that is yearning for healing today. Lord, would you bring healing today? And a spirit of restoration, Lord, that it's not just healing, but all areas of life are restored and renewed in Jesus' name. Lord, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. I pray that you've been encouraged today through this broadcast today. I pray that you are experiencing a measure of hope and encouragement in your walk with God today. We do pray and believe for healing to come to you today in Jesus' name. And as we close our time together, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine on you and be good and gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his favor over you, and may he give you his peace. Amen and amen.
Jesus.